Hey, it's Kay, and this is Skittles, aviation instructor. Today we're gonna do something we've never done on this channel before. We're gonna look at something out of the MCU. A big part of the reason I've avoided talking about Marvel movies is honestly just that I think they often have very little to say. And what they do have to say is usually a very disinterested endorsement of the current status quo, framed in such a broad way that almost anybody could watch it and not feel like their worldview is being challenged. That's probably how you turn the box office charts into this in just a few years. But there's a show on Disney Plus that perfectly encapsulates all the most disturbing ideas that are regularly and uncritically reproduced in the MCU and in superhero fiction more broadly. Partially due to worse than usual writing, it wears these ideas on its sleeve in a really unique way that just begs us to ask what kind of ideas this massive media empire is putting out into the collective psyche of millions of viewers. So today we're going to look at the ideology of Falcon and the Winter Soldier. One of the central conflicts in this story is Sam Wilson, aka Falcon Man, grappling with whether or not to accept the mantle of Captain America. The show plays a little coy with why exactly Sam is so hesitant to do so. Initially, he seems to feel that he can't fill the shoes of Steve Rogers, or maybe that he doesn't think anyone should be trying to fill his shoes. But as the episodes go on, it becomes clear that there's more to it than that. Sam is struggling with what it means to be a black man and become the poster boy for America. A country that has historically enslaved, segregated, and dehumanized black people, and in which he is still subject to racism. In one scene, he's saved from a potentially dangerous run-in with a cop because he recognizes him as a celebrity superhero, a member of the Avengers. The implication is that without his status, this could have gone very differently. MCU movies often shy away from more substantial political commentary like this, so the premise of Sam trying to reconcile America's past and present racism with the possibility of becoming Captain America is really interesting. It gets even more interesting when Sam meets Isaiah Bradley. Isaiah is an exploration of what Captain America's origin story might have looked like if he wasn't white, but was instead a black man in Jim Crow America. While Rogers was informed of the risks of taking the experimental super serum, Isaiah and 500 other black soldiers were given the serum without their consent. They were told it was a vaccine.
Those stars and stripes don't mean nothing good to me.
Bradley became a super soldier in the 50s, working for the US military, but his service in a world that had recently lost their Captain America didn't result in him becoming the new captain. It resulted in him being imprisoned, experimented on, and tortured by the state for 30 years. Isaiah explains all of this to Sam in the best and possibly only good scene in this entire show. He ends by telling him,
"They will never let a black man be Captain America. And even if they did, no self-respecting black man would ever want to be."
This is honestly a really significant question that's being posed here, especially for a comic book show for babies. As a member of a group who have been so mistreated by America, should you accept an opportunity to secure yourself a higher standing within that system that is doing so much harm to people like you? Or do you have some responsibility to oppose that system entirely? Isaiah strongly endorses the position held by many significant black radicals throughout history that the liberation of oppressed people as a whole cannot be achieved by, and may even be antithetical to, individuals from oppressed groups gaining relative wealth or power for themselves. Don't take it from me, though.
He's out of line, but he's right.
I've included a small reading list in the description of this video, ranging from Huey Newton to Frantz Fanon, exploring this question and the history behind it far better than I can here. Isaiah's words seem to really resonate with Sam, and he's posed a challenge that brings Sam's worldview into question. How does he navigate the contradiction of becoming a figurehead of the state that wouldn't even have let him vote a few generations ago? I'll tell you how. In the next scene, he just shrugs and says, "Sucks to be that guy, but I'm built different."
Turn down for what?
All right, he does give a reason. It's just amazing how quickly he dismisses what Isaiah had to say. Sam says,
Isaiah's been to hell and back. If I was in his shoes, I'd probably feel the exact same way. But what would be the point of all the pain and sacrifice if I wasn't willing to stand up and keep fighting?
Presumably, he's referring to the civil rights movement and everyone who fought for the liberation of Black Americans before and after them. In other words, he's asserting that all of those struggles against the state, against white supremacy, were struggles that are continued by Sam taking up the shield and becoming Captain America. Those struggles for liberation in Birdo and the Iceman become reimagined as struggles for assimilation. Not of an opposition to America as it exists, but of a wish to be included in America as it exists. I'm reminded of the optimism a lot of people had that Obama's presidency would mark a turning point in the struggle to end racism in America. I think we all remember how that worked out. Isaiah's pain is treated as real and justified, but his worldview is ultimately relegated to that of a bitter old man, stuck in the past. While Sam's belief that the system can be improved from within is presented as the progressive way forward, being subsumed by the institutions of the state becomes liberation. Keep that theme in mind because it'll come up again later. So, despite everything we've covered so far, the American state is not, in fact, the main antagonist of this show. This is where things really go off the rails. Our would-be Captain America and this guy who people keep telling me is a main character in this show, but I'm not seeing it. They team up to stop a group of anarchists who dress up in a way clearly intended to invoke masked anti-fascist protesters. And they are called the Flag Smashers. That is not a joke. Now, when I say anarchist, I do so knowing that the word is often used in fiction to just describe people doing crimes and causing trouble. But the Flag Smashers do have ideological positions that are drawn from actual anarchist ideas. Kind of. They don't have much to say about the state in general, but they are primarily concerned with borders, which of course are enforced by states. This is relevant because the events of this show coincide with a refugee crisis caused by half of the world's population suddenly returning from non-existence after 5 years due to Thanos doing his whole mass murder thing. And this is where anything even resembling a coherent ideology comes to an end, because the thing about the Flag Smashers is they think the world was better during the blip, the 5 year period in which half of all life on Earth was gone. Their reasoning for this is based on the fact that after immediately losing half of their population, many rich Western countries fully opened their borders in an effort to replace their lost workforce, effectively creating a borderless world in which people could move freely. Nobody really mentions the economic consequences this must have had on poorer countries who also lost half their population and then had a mass exodus of workers hoping to get better pay in places like the US, but who cares, right? Wanting open borders is one thing, but by specifically framing it as we want to go back to how things were during the blip, things were better during the blip, this show has created a situation where the Flag Smashers are telling us Thanos was right. This is a problem because throughout those two very long movies in which Thanos walks around making Reddit posts about how it'll totally fix all our problems if he just kills half of all life in the universe, nobody ever really makes a substantial critique of his plan. People call him crazy and evil, and it's generally understood that it would be bad if this happens. And after it happens, Captain Marvel suggests there's been tons of instability throughout the galaxy because of this, and Earth is at least looking kinda worse for wear after the blip. But nobody ever really engages with Thanos' ideological position. Nobody ever says, hey, the number of people isn't the problem, it's how society is organized. And by the way, the Infinity Stones would allow you to solve these problems in a million different ways that don't involve killing billions, so what the fuck? But likewise, nobody except Thanos ever really argues for his plan. You never get the feeling anyone aside from people who already serve him is hearing his ideas and going, oh yeah, that'll work. And the people who live through the blip pretty consistently do not describe it as a good time, except for the Flag Smashers. The anarchists are the only people in the MCU who are explicitly telling us that what Thanos did actually made things better in some way. So, again, what the fuck? This is especially bizarre because the Flag Smashers are ultimately advocating for something pretty inoffensive. They don't want to re-murder half the people on Earth, they just want to go back to having open borders like they did before. So at this point, we're really struggling to see these guys as villains. The MCU often struggles with this, so they've developed a handy trick of having a villain with a valid point, and even good ideas, but they use violence, so sadly, we must disregard it. Or Hav-Wav Pegib Tuv Swimdi for short. So, right on schedule, the leader of the Flag Smashers, you guys know how much anarchists love leaders and hierarchical structures, right? Well, she has to do something villainous enough for we the audience to see her as, you know, a bad guy. So they have her blow up a building full of civilian hostages, for no reason. Seriously, no reason. Another Flag Smasher asks her why she did it, and she says it's the only language they understand. Who the fuck is they? The state? Those were just random people. What are you talking about? Anarchists are one of the few groups you can name who don't go around murdering random civilians. This is where the already bad writing in the show is at its worst, because they clearly knew they needed to have that story beat at that point, because their antagonists weren't really doing anything that bad. They're mostly just robbing banks, which is, who cares, fuck banks, and trying to get the government to open their borders for refugees. So it was time for them to do something cartoonishly evil, so that when our protagonist, in the employ of the American state, takes them out, we don't get any confusing feelings that lead us to ask questions. In a short essay by Tom Frum, this trend in fiction is referred to as the swerve. There's a common trope in media where it's revealed, most often near the end of the story, but sometimes right off the bat, that trying too hard to do good makes you evil. The message is unequivocal. Having good politics doesn't make you fit to rule. Having no politics does. The restoration of the status quo is the best we can hope for. This can be seen all throughout popular culture, and especially in superhero fiction. Take Black Panther's Killmonger and his justified criticism of Wakanda for standing by and doing nothing throughout centuries of slavery and colonialism, as well as his plan to arm colonized people around the globe to defend themselves. But then he's inexplicably violent towards women and goes, oh, by the way, I'm going to be the king of this decolonized world, basically defeating the whole purpose. Not because violence against women or world domination are genuine shortcomings of the ideas Killmonger represents, but because the writers need to include something so that when a hereditary monarch, in collaboration with the literal CIA, kills him, we don't feel like maybe we're being asked to root for the bad guys. You can see this exact same dynamic repeated beat for beat throughout fiction. And again, Falcor and King Cold stands out as a particularly egregious example of this because all we're really given is they kill people. Which is like, okay, thank God our protagonist isn't signing up to be the poster child of the largest military on the planet or anything like that, or this would feel pretty silly. See, the Flag Smashers, aside from being pretty incoherent and bizarrely cool with Thanos wiping out billions of humans, are also a very shallow depiction of anarchist beliefs. Sure, anarchists oppose the borders that states enforce, but there's a lot of other issues they take with states. Things like having a monopoly on the legitimate use of force. That's an interesting one because despite the show expecting us to believe that Sam is struggling with whether he can or should represent America as a black man, he sure never had any problem fighting for America as a black man. Seems like he's had that one figured out for a long time. The first episode features the US military using Sam to break international law by illegally entering Libyan airspace with his special wings, which by the way are American manufactured military weapons. This never really comes up again and isn't depicted as bad in any way because the things that the US does militarily aren't up for debate. Those are facts. Those are neutral factors. What this show takes aim at as the real problems are individual actors making bad decisions. Sam has no beef with the US military, but when the head Flag Smasher kills a few people, they simply have to be stopped because they are not representing a state. They do not have permission to carry out violence. The show takes that as a given in a way that does far more to bolster the arguments of real-world anarchists than it does to refute them. But the focus on individual actors gets far worse than that. After defeating the Flag Smooshers, Birdman approaches a group of senators who had been shown endlessly debating how to respond to the refugee crisis caused by the blipped people returning, and he just tells them to be better, and that's it. No, seriously, he tells them that they aren't listening to marginalized people enough, which is why they are making bad decisions. Not out of malice, not out of class interest, not because they are subject to economic and political institutions way beyond their control, but innocent ignorance.
Who's in the room with you when you're making those decisions? Is it the people you're going to impact?
You've got to do better, Senator.
What's being very aggressively stated here is that the solution to our problems is not any kind of systemic change. It's just a matter of our leaders needing to hear the right voices so they can do better. Who knew it would be so easy to solve a refugee crisis? Why haven't we thought of giving our leaders a good talking to? We should develop an entire genre of TV shows who just try to do that. I'm sure that'll fix things. Not long after Frosty and the Snowman came out, the CIA released a recruitment ad that featured a woman who described herself as a daughter of immigrants, a woman of color, and an intersectional millennial with an anxiety disorder, talking about how inclusive and great the CIA is.
I am a woman of color. I am a mom. I am a cisgender millennial who's been diagnosed with generalized anxiety disorder. I am intersectional.
Do you see the ideological position we're being primed to accept? The US military isn't bad. The CIA isn't bad. The state and capitalism are not bad. They've just been run by privileged people, by white men who won't listen to the voices of the marginalized. That's all. This means that all it takes to make these institutions good and solve our biggest problems as a society is for marginalized people to be heard, to be seen.
Hear one another. See one another.
I hear you.
I hear you.
That's right. Come join the CIA, and you too can orchestrate inclusive coups in South America. Or maybe you can work as a torturer at a black site running illegal human experiments on someone just like Isaiah Bradley from hit show Falcon and the Winter Soldier. Now available on Disney Plus. And if you're unlucky enough to be in one of those bad countries that's standing between American capital and the resources they want to exploit, don't worry. When you and your family are killed by a drone strike, you can pass into the next world comforted by your knowledge that a woman of color pulled the trigger. There's a scene right at the end of the last episode where Sam brings Isaiah to the museum we've seen a couple times with the big Captain America installation. Sam shows Isaiah that he's had a statue of him installed that tells his story. There's tears in Isaiah's eyes as if this was some reconciliation, some closure after having his life destroyed. The ideology of this show is that politics is not change. Politics is not solving problems. Politics is gestures. Saying the right things, making sure the right people feel seen and heard. Every now and then, America can raise a statue to show that it cares, while it destroys black lives at home and abroad, every day. But they had to have that scene, didn't they? Otherwise, we might find ourselves walking away from Falcon and the Winter Soldier with confusing feelings that lead us to ask questions.
America, for